Well.
Damn, Wittershins again.
It's like the second half.
Yeah, it was like we're just breaking it into two episodes. We planned to do that, man. I totally planned to like stop in the middle of that story and do that. Yeah. You believe that? You believe that, right? Alright, well. Now we gotta play a song or something to recover from whatever the fuck just happened. They're trying to get us, man. They're trying to get us. We need to pray. We need to pray.
of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Holy,
holy, holy.
Thank you, Jesus.
Wittershins.
Wittershins.
Yeah, shit happened. I don't know what that was. Somehow, I'm not going to try and read that story again. Something in that story twitched and it turned off the speaker. You can't have it turning off the speaker.
My battery is sufficiently charged.
That is good.
That
is good news. I don't know. Somebody didn't want us talking about politics, man. But long story short, shorter than the story that we're not going to try and read again. Poppets can be traced back to ancient Greece, and probably further back than that. But the use of effigy, a likeness of the thing that, or the person that you're doing the magic on, is as old as the dirt. And when we have a lot of these arguments about cultural appropriation and stuff, and this comes up all the time. It's like, you used a doll, you stole that from my ancestors. Like, no, my ancestors, their ancestors, their ancestors, their ancestors, everybody's fucking ancestors came up with similar ideas. And I understand everybody has their cultural issues, everybody has arguments and stuff, but the longer I go and the more magics that I study, I see more similarity than I see differences. There's, issues between cultures that they gotta work out. I understand that, but magically speaking, everybody came up with the same ideas, and it didn't matter where they were or if the cultures had contact or had the ability to appropriate or dominate or steal or any of that kind of thing. People came up with the same ideas magically and spiritually and religiously all around the world. And that makes more sense for my upbringing. I was taught they said a bunch of vague, huge things that you would have to figure out what the fuck they were talking about for the rest of your life. One I've been working on my whole life, the craft is heard on the wind and seen in the wild. And there's a plethora that has come to mean, but I still don't yet know the meaning of that. And that damn song, Amen, is still running in the background. I hope that's a cool, I hope it's a cool background music for my speak over. I can't hear it on this. What am I talking about?
Well, it's fine.
Oh dear. The craft is heard on the wind and seen in the wild. I've come to know, seen in the wild, there are certain patterns in nature that we perceive as witches that represent constants in the universe or in nature that are then laws. I recognize no laws in magic that I cannot see reflected in nature in some symbolic form. That's why I don't recognize the threefold law. Heard on the wind is way more complicated. The wind, as we're taught in craft, is thought, electricity, energy, and very ideas, dreams. All of these things are wind. And it always shocked me, way years ago before anybody I ever even heard of cultural appropriation or anything like it. I was originally shocked at how many indigenous cultures had a ritual space marked off by a circle and the four quarters crossed through the middle. And some of the places where I saw this happen were like cultures that we only knew about because people kept digging their way into the rainforest. And nobody had ever met these people before, but now that we cut down all the trees to get there, now we're meeting them. And they probably died off shortly after that, but that particular symbol for a religious space comes up way too often, all over the world, everywhere I've seen. And you know, it's subconscious based on the things we see around us. It's a no-brainer to the ancient culture, but you know, just little things like that, and then things like this, like the idea that you can make a likeness of a person and then do a thing to that likeness to attract the action of that likeness to that person. That's sympathetic magic. We see that most fully expressed in the laws of magic that come from hermetics, like attracts like. Countless magics use that. And I have often used like voodoo to be the best example of that. You know, you make a doll of this person, you have their hair, their fingernails, that kind of thing in it, and then you stick pins in it for that thing to happen to the person. And I don't know much about voodoo, but I don't know that much about it. I know what Hollywood taught me, but that much is accurate. You make a doll with links to that person, or in other traditions called personal concerns of that person, and then you do things to that doll to attract the likeness of those things to that person. Sympathetic magic, old as the fucking dirt. Everybody did it. Nobody has claim to it, but see, I'm not many of my colleagues are trying to reclaim their particular pieces of the pie, and I recognize that. But I'm not there. And maybe, you know, I've been trying to reclaim my other pieces of the pie my whole life, my whole witchcraft life. It reclaims like which piece of the pie came from where, which fractionalized culture of paganism did that come from. I want that. I don't take away anybody else's, path to doing that. But I'm more fascinated with the similarities than the differences. And I find that I have a much more material, much more content. If I were to do a podcast on the differences between magical traditions and spiritual traditions around the world, I would have much less content to work with than if I was doing a podcast about the similarities between all of the same. These ideas float through the air, maybe. Maybe they all come from our ancestors. Maybe they're in our DNA. They're in our ancestral memory, which contains the ancestral memory of the entirety of the human race and not just segments of the human race. Maybe it's that. I don't know. But these drastically similar ideas in spirituality, magic, and religion pop up all over the world. And I'm more fascinated by that than the differences. And I think I'd have more content to provide on that subject than the other. And the poppets. Poppets brought me to that because I've run into that. I've run into that a lot in some hoodoo and conjure groups. I enter into these arguments with people that clearly have not read enough books. And I'm looking at these people, and I'm not even wanting to have an argument sometimes, because it's the argument's so ignorant, the argument's so devoid of bookwork or scholarship. I just often want to say to people, like, God, you know, Your ancestors were forbidden to read. Were forbidden to go to school. You know, and forbidden to go to the white people's schools. Like, fucking educate yourself now. Read some fucking books. There's just like so many people out there having arguments that haven't read the books, even on their own traditions, let alone my traditions or where they differ, that want to argue on social media. It's like, even Google, in this day and age, even hoodoo and conjure can be Googled. You know, you Google, you know, how do I do this, that, and the other hoodoo conjure? You're going to get an answer for that. You know, how do I do this, that, and the other Strega? You get an answer for that. How do I do this, that, and the other Celtic? Well, whatever you got, you're going to get an answer for that. It's all out there for anybody to access. So that was the article about poppets, where we could at least trace them back to, you know, ancient Greece, probably beyond that. But, you know, that's when they started to write shit down. So we have a lot more records from that time period. There's this other one I wanted to try and read. Hopefully that weird thing won't happen that happened with the last one. Yeah. This one I always think of. Is it going to load? Oh, jeez. You're listening to Wittershins where I'm waiting for a story to load. I'm going to go back to the app, wait for the story to load, and then go back so it doesn't kick the app off again. Let's see. What was this from? ReligionNews.com. Well, this one caught my attention right away. Soviet power gone. Baltic countries' historic pagan past reemerges. And this, I've been waiting for this. I've been wanting to know more about my wife's culture and where she came from. The clown to the right of me. And more of this every year. More stuff, or there'll be like more, you know, pagan groups getting organized in that region of the world. But as they do that, they come up with more history that we didn't know about. Everybody's pagan history is buried for one church or another, or one you know, government or another, and it takes time for people to reclaim that. Oh no, I hope the page isn't still reloading. Stop. There we go. I want to read this. Sama, Estonia. In the middle of the dense forest in the northern Estonia, where the closest village has a population of 32, only a wooden sign with the word HIIS, clumsily daubed in between green, indicates anything unusual in the vicinity. HIIS means sacred grove in Estonian. Past another wooden board with a runic symbol carved on it, is customary to knock on this board, is a green clearing where visitors have tied ribbons around trees, placed eggs at their bases as a gift, and left the dark remnants of fire. All that is brought there has to be eaten there or burned in the ritual fire, said 20-year-old Tanya Rahela, who has been a member of the Estonia's nature-oriented neo-pagan Mausk community since he was 16. Though in fire, the gods... Oh, God, that's epic. All right. Through the fire, the gods eat. Through the holy tree, the gods drink. Oh, God, I teared up trying to read that. That's beautiful. While pagan and folk religions may seem archaic to the wider world, they are thriving across the Baltic states. The Marusk community, along with Estonia's other... Did you not? Prominent neo-pagan group, the Tarists, tripled in size from 2001 to 2011, the latest figures available from the National Census. Meanwhile, 2014, study of the University of Tartu indicated 61% of Estonians believed that neo-paganism was the true religion of Estonia. There is similar situation in both Latvia and Lithuania. The increase in
I know.
I know, babies.
Okay.
That's why these stories fascinate me. The increase in popularity in mainly young people in said Anisia Trinku. Help me.
I don't know those accents.
You can't do it either.
No, I did fine then.
The high priestess known as Kaiv of the Lithuania's Ramuva community. More and more people are asking for us to perform wedding ceremonies. They want to have their children blessed by the ancient traditions, she said. Adding this is true even of the people who aren't officially of the community. People more and more are becoming aware of what they really are. Okay, so I teared up at a portion of that. Could barely finish that story, but that's... I didn't even know. Okay, so if you're new to Wittershins, most often when I have a news story, I, like you, will grab the headline and go, oh, I like that headline, and I save the story, and then I read the story live on the air for the first time so I can be shocked with the rest of you, and a lot of that blew me away. I'm going to have to go read the rest of that story, and you can read the rest of that story. I think I said it was religionnews.com, and the headline was... Soviet power gone, Baltic countries' historic pagan past reemerges by Alid Naylor. That kind of thing, just I lost track, but it's like in the beginning of the text, the ancient pagan traditions that I've seen in most of the pagan traditions that I've known were there, that the eggs and the stick, and it's like, you know, go back and listen to what I just said. It's like, right away, none of that was unfamiliar, but it comes from a region, my wife's, you know, ancestral region, where it's been buried for longer than most. You know, most people, you know, their pagan traditions were buried during the Middle Ages, and then they had a pagan renaissance from beyond that time. Not so in the communist countries. Even regular religion, even just like, you know, the churches in those regions, you know, they were more suppressed even too. But all religion, all spirituality, I'm suppressive. I when I see people like that reclaiming their things from so far back, you know, does my heart good. And I see right away the similarities in their paganism and paganisms that I know, magics that I know. And it doesn't take anything away from me. It doesn't take anything away from Marta. I'm sorry, I was drinking for a second. It doesn't take anything away from Marta. It enhances the human experience. We are practicing witchcrafts from all over the world, and somehow our ancestors all over the world had similar ideas. What I see all over the world is different expressions of those ideas, and in those we can celebrate. But more fascinating to me is that the same ideas manifest worldwide. Black, white, yellow, brown, red, green. It doesn't matter. No matter who you are. Your ancestors we're coming up with a lot of the same ideas. Just looking up at the sky, watching nature and stuff. And that fascinates me more than anything else. I see the chat room still rolling. I gotta do this. Hold on.
What?
I gotta plug the thing, man.
Plug what thing?
Oh, you'll see the thing. You know the thing. Don't act like you don't know what thing I'm gonna plug.
I don't know what thing you're gonna
plug. Oh, you know what thing I'm gonna plug. Hexfest!
Oh, yeah, Hexfest.
Join in the magic. Tales of the magic of the Crescent City of New Orleans stretch back over the centuries. It's an enigmatic place where hoodoo, voodoo, witchcraft, and even Christianity blend at the crossroads of spiritual power. On August 9th to the 11th, 2019, Brian Kane, Christian Day, and the Witches of New Orleans present Hexfest, a weekend of witchery held in the heart of the historic French Quarter. The conference opens with a riverboat ritual and dinner held on an authentic steamboat on the Mississippi River, followed by two full days of workshops, drumming, and ritual at the Bourbon's Orleans Hotel, a venue riddled with a history of hauntings. Hexfest has gathered witches, root workers, voodoo priests, and other magical teachers from within New Orleans and around the world to offer their time-honored wisdom. Between workshops, attendees will love the magical shopping in our on-site vending hall, where you can purchase powerful ritual tools, signed books, exquisite jewelry, and spellcrafts handmade by true practitioners. Presenters for the 2019 Hexfest hail from across the spectrum of witchcraft and magic and include Brian Kane, Christian Day, Austin Shippey, Byron Ballard, Kerry O'Crow, Christine Steffens, Dorothy Morrison, the Dragon Ritual Drummers, Fiona Horn, Hoodoo Sen Moise, Lady Rhea, Laura Tempest Zaycroft, Michael Carell, Rosemary Ellen Gilly, Sally Ann Glassman, Sandra Maria Wright, Sen Elias, Sorita Deste, Starcassus, Star Ravenhawk, Witch Doctor Utu, and Yeshe Matthews. My lung capacity is getting better. I don't think I had to take a big deep breath for that
one. I'm gonna order Chinese.
Okay. Whether you're a beginner or an advanced practitioner, Hexfest will help you discover the secrets of witchcraft and expand your mastery of the magical arts. You need to go to hexfest.com, man. You want to meet Uncle Birch and the clown to the right of me, Marta? Well, I don't know where else you're going to do that, man. We don't make public appearances that often. But Hexfest, that's going to be one of them, man. You need to go to hexfest.com and get them tickets because they're selling fast, man. You know, tell them, I don't know if there's a place to tell them. Tell them you're just there to see Uncle Birch, man. Marta,
yeah.
my clown to the right of me, August 9th, it's coming up, man. It's coming up. It's right around the corner. You gotta go, man. You gotta go. They're posting the link in the chat room, man. I'm sure it's gonna sell out. It's epic. It's huge. Our first time in New Orleans. We're gonna try not to die. St. Elias told me I need to wear all whites, really thin all whites, and shorts and sandals. So I can sport that look probably. And I'm sure Marta can sport that look too. We've had our time in whites. We pull that off. Maybe I'll, you know, bring some blacks around for night. Maybe it'll be dark enough for blacks. I don't know. I think at night it still absorbs heat, so I don't know. But we have experts telling us what to do. Mosquito repellent's probably good too. They have mosquitoes. Oh, are we gonna see dragonflies? Ooh, you might see dragonflies. Isn't that the areas? You know, down the.
You mean fireflies?
Oh, I'm sorry. You're right. Fucking editor. Yeah, fireflies. Okay, we see dragonflies all the time, but isn't like Louisiana, is that where they have those things?
You already asked me that, and I think I looked it up, and I think they don't really. I think not so much.
All right, I'm a hope but for. I'm, not sure. I'm gonna hope to see a damn firefly, man, because I've only seen those at Disneyland on the Pirates of the Caribbean ride. They're not quite the same.
Totally. You know,
artificial fireflies, but yeah. I'm not sure if I had. I think I had another story. Okay, there's Hexfest. Okay. This one's been causing quite a stir of late. Let's see, who the hell wrote this? Jason Mankey. Thought he was on vacation still or something like that. All right. Well, May 31st, Jason Mankey wrote this little article that's causing quite a stir. And we find it on Patheos Pagan. Why can't there be Christian witches? I noticed someone on social media lamenting a Christian witches convention that took place in Salem, Massachusetts in past April. Never mind the event is already over. I'm much more bothered by the policing of both the witch and Christian worlds and the idea that there's no such thing as a Christian witch. I admit that I don't understand people self-identifying as Christian witches in the pagan world, but I do have to understand something to be accepting of it. There are also a whole lot of witchcraft traditions that have Christianity quietly tucked into their DNA somewhere. Nothing emerges in a vacuum, and for the last 1700 years, Christianity has been the elephant in the room. It's only logical that a whole lot of witch traditions might have been influenced by Christianity. Modern witchcraft is not an offshoot of Christianity, but Christianity has impacted at least a bit of what some of us do. Christianity has also influenced Buddhism, Hinduism, and Islam over the last 1500 years, and ancient paganism influenced Christianity and Judaism 2000 years ago, and in the case of Judaism, further out than that. This is how religious and belief systems work. To think that the witch community somehow stands outside that paradigm is sheer hubris. One document consisted of notes officially taken by a man who was initiated into a magical group from elderly women of Oxfordshire, village in which he lived in the years around 1940. They were part of the teachings of this group and consisted of various magical uses to which 26 of the biblical Psalms could be put, sometimes consisting of the whole psalm and sometimes of a single verse. There are obviously classical Christian folk magic of a sort recorded copiously from the early Middle Ages to the 20th century, although the special importance of the psalms, the Protestants would suggest that the use of them post-dates Reformation. You may not have heard of Andrew Chumley, but his impact on modern witchcraft for the last 20 years has been extraordinary. Much of the current rise in, quote, traditional witchcraft can be traced in no small part to the work of Chumley, who spent years documenting magical techniques and practices, most notably his own Sabbatic tradition. Chumley wasn't Christian, but if he used texts written about above in his magical work, he was most certainly influenced by Christianity. And in the world of traditional witchcraft, such influences are common. Not outliners. As Chumley is also majorly responsible for the boom in high-quality witchcraft books from specialty publishers. The first person most of us think of when it comes to traditional witchcraft is Robert Cochrane, whose witch group was and still is the Clan of Tubal Cain. Tubal Cain was a famous Hebrew blacksmith, not a figure from Greek mythology. Traditional witchcraft also often references figures such as Lucifer or the devil, and we all know where he came from. I just pick up my copy of The Red Goddess and immediately notice the quotation from Song of Songs. That's a book in the Bible. On the back, not to mention all of the quotes from the Book of Revelations, which feature prominently in this text. And if you read a lot of traditional witchcraft books, you've no doubt run into figures such as Nephilim, Watchers, Enoch. Where do people think this stuff comes from? And, you know, the article's going to go on. I never read the whole one for you. You got to go to patheos.com, look at Jason Mankey's column, Patheos Pagan. My whole take on Christian witches is, for me, a witch... A witch is reading... Hold on, I gotta check. Everything okay? Hey! I gotta go check on this shit. We'll be right back. I gotta go check on a weird sound in my house.
A new age of reason. Brain treason to trick the mind. What good is searching if nothing's there to find? We arrive at this place of no return, my brothers, only to discover that our minds have led us away. So far from the paper truth of who we are. What's right is wrong, what's gone is gone, what's clear and pure is not so sure. Come forth, bear witness. See the prophet from your laws. Beg for forgiveness only after you tally the cost. We arrive at this place of no return, my sisters, only to discover that our values ran off the ground. On the show, in the sea of what we could be. What's right is wrong, what's gone is gone. Promises become a lie. All that's been right corrupts and dies.
Bad Religion. Well, Wittershins Radio, always a good choice. I don't know, the dogs were barking at some crap, but nothing going on. My take on this thing, yes, there is a lot of Christian witchery or Christianity and witchery. My take has always been that a witch, to me, should be reading a different code. There's a code of symbols beyond the language. And my take on the Bible is that that code is present, but overlooked. Planets, stars, these things were people in the Bible. And the majority of the characters in the Bible can be equated to planets and stars. And if you know me and you know the story, I've already said this. In the ancient Sumerian legends, they told of the formation of the solar system in a way that was beyond, you know, our science is only catching up to what the Sumerians said. And it turned out that everything that the Sumerians said about the solar system was correct. And they spoke of the early origins of this solar system, and that there was a planet that was on an elliptical orbit. And that planet was named Cain. And that on one of the passes on its elliptical orbit in the early formation of the solar system, it slew its brother Abel, which was also a planet. Cain slaying Abel was told by the Sumerians as a tale between two planets. They said that when Cain slew Abel, Abel became an asteroid belt, and where they said that asteroid belt should be is exactly where an asteroid belt is. There's nothing left of the Sumerian legends that hasn't been proven by science. There may be something. But one of the last ones was water on the moon, our moon. And that's been proven. We now know there's frozen water at the poles of the moon. The Sumerians told that. They told the story of every planet in our solar system and all the moons of those planets. And in the way that they told them, they sometimes told them as people. Characters. Lucifer, the symbol of the rising sun. Venus, maybe far enough back they thought Venus was a star. A lot of people think Venus is a star to this day. But now we know that Lucifer was a planet. Lucifer rose, and Lucifer fell. Lucifer went retrograde. And the fall of a planet, the fall back of a planet in ancient astrology was often described that way, a retrograde. A Venus retrograde in conjunction with a meteor storm of 72 meteors. That's my guess on all this. I can totally be wrong, but of all my looks, like, the Bible is a calendar, a metaphorical calendar of ancient lore, and quite often it's pointing to when a thing happened or when a thing's going to happen, and nobody's recognizing the code anymore. In biblical speak, wise means witch, magician, magic user of some kind, even the three wise men. And it turns out the three wise men probably represent the three stars in Orion's belt, in which countless mysticisms, magics, and spiritual traditions point to is the origins of humankind.
Makes sense to me.
You need to find my red and black pajama bottoms.
I need to find your red and black pajama bottoms.
Yes.
All right. Well, you're listening to Wittershins, and in just a minute here, I'm going to have to go find some red and black pajama bottoms.
Yeah, because they
bottoms.
Look exactly like Sasha's, and you obviously thought my pair was Sasha's pair.
Oh, is that what obviously happened?
I'm an adult. I don't lose my pajama bottoms.
You're listening to Wittershins. I think I made my point. You can find us at wittershinsradio@gmail.com. You can find us at Wittershins on Facebook. We don't have Twitter yet, right? I don't think we have a Twitter Wittershins yet, though we do post through other accounts.
I'm too wordy for Twitter.
Yeah, it's kind of a problem. You're a wordy bitch. Yeah. Instagram, we don't have an Instagram either, but we post it on those things through other accounts, but we don't have those. But you can find us on Facebook at Wittershins Radio. Find us on Gmail at wittershinsradio@gmail.com. And all over the damn map. I'm getting ready for another year and a day course in witchcraft. Starting August 1st, you can find out about that on my YouTube channel at FreakPhil1309. That's FreakPhil, and the number's 1309. And, well, it's been a pleasure serving you this evening. Have a good week.
I haven't even started serving.
I'm talking about them.
Oh.
Serving them.
Okay.
Not you. It's early. God. Wittershins.
People aren't looking for a hand.
true of you. When first I saw you, I realized the fire burned deep behind your eyes. It's true. Sometimes changes are hard to confront.
listen, and I'll be blunt. I want destruction. Destruction. I want destruction. Destruction. Change it around. Change it. Be careful with what you change. And always use wisdom in what you rearrange. For in this world there is good and there is evil. So don't mistake change for evil.